Hello. Is talking to yourself a sign of madness? And is talking to a camera in my bathroom any better? But what the hell does insanity mean, anyway? Does insane mean irrational? And then, isn't an irrational person necessarily insane? I mean, an irrational person will behave unpredictably, and an unpredictable person, the reasoning goes, is dangerous. So this insanely irrational person must be locked up. I mean, they're a danger to society at large. We don't want to do it, but we have no choice. And anyway, it's for their own good. Right? Sterilized white walls, strip lighting, isolation. We're familiar with ideas of psychiatric hospitals from films and television, but just how long have they been a thing? In Madness and Civilization, French philosopher Michel Foucault writes that the development of such imprisonment arrived in 1656 in Paris. It was euphemistically named the General Hospital, and it wasn't nearly as clean as my bathroom. The General Hospital was like a city within a city. It contained 1% of Paris's population living under totalitarian control. The newly created job of mad housekeeper combined horse handling techniques with iron manacles and chains. This model swept through the continent in an age Foucault termed the Great Confinement. Criminals, the unemployed and the insane were all locked up together to be corrected. After all, they were all equally irrational and therefore equally dangerous. Despite this extreme out of sight, out of mind policy, the public were fascinated with the mad. And asylums cashed in by charging spectators for entry. Songwriters and poets even got in on the deal by penning top 10 hits told from the perspective of fictional inmates like Mad Maudlin and Tom of Bedlam.
Bonny mad boys, Bedlam boys are bonny, and they all go bare and they live by the air and they want no drink or money.
Okay, you get the idea. After 100 years of this, in steps our hero, Philippe Pinel. He unchains a group of the insane, an act which gets himself labelled insane by the authorities. But Pinel had come to the conclusion that the insane were merely sick and not criminals. But okay, Pinel wasn't that much of a hero. When he said sick, he didn't mean mentally ill like we might today. He was speaking more of a sickness of character, the type of thing that Cards Against Humanity revels in. And his pioneering moral treatment for the insane placed great focus on discipline, with more than a little nod to religious concerns. To Pinel, the insane had the irrationality of children, which is just a little more compassionate than treating the insane as having the irrationality of criminals or wild animals. That compassion has eked its way in, little by little, over the centuries, and today we use things like group discussion and occupational therapies like playing music to help people. But interestingly, this isn't as cutting edge and as modern as it seems. In the medieval Muslim world, the polymath stroke physician Abu Zayd Al-Balkhi's books introduced the concept of mental health, and he recommended treating the mentally ill through friendly companionship, pleasant conversation, and music therapy too. Okay, again, I'm not sure that music would help. So now we know what society will do to people they think are insane. Depending when and where they're from, they'll either get locked up like criminals, or get some moral treatment, or even just listen to some nice music. And if you hit that mid to late 20th century sweet spot, they'll electrocute you, pump you full of drugs, and then dramatise the whole thing and turn it into Oscar bait. But, am I insane? How do you know if you are insane? Let's find out by playing the Are You Insane quick quiz game. Question one. And remember, you're playing for an all-expenses one-way trip to the General Hotel. Do you think you are a robot? Wait, hear me out. Specifically, have you ever felt like Alan Peel, who was playing his PS4 and felt himself being reprogrammed through the controller by enemy forces into a bionic being? Alan describes such episodes as creating a mental world that had their own internal self-consistency and logic, that only afterwards, looking back, appeared irrational. To me, this seems a bit like how your mind works when you're sort of in that half-sleep state, or when you're trying to write some high sci-fi. Okay, no? Next question then. Are you a card-carrying member of one of the 29 Hearing Voices networks? Many people experience auditory hallucinations, and the Hearing Voice Network advocates an approach that listens to both the hearer and to their voices and treats them with respect. For example, hearer Eleanor Longden describes the voices as a sane reaction to the insane circumstances that could befall those unlucky in life. After all, people develop all sorts of coping strategies, from the harmless to the intrusive. Still no? Okay, final question. Do you think you are not insane? Tony has spent 12 years in Broadmoor Mental Hospital in England. Journalist John Ronson discovered him after finding out that Tony claimed to have faked insanity to avoid a GBH charge in court. He was successful, but eventually he came clean to the staff, telling them that he'd used films like A Clockwork Orange and Blue Velvet to feign mental illness. However, they concluded that feigning mental illness is itself a sign of mental illness, and Tony remained trapped, refusing to accept his new diagnosis as a psychopath and maintaining his sanity. What this comes down to is what's known in philosophy as phenomenology. That from within your own head, all you have are your thoughts and the information from your senses to make judgments about the world. And if there's a problem with either of those, you might behave a little odd from the outside, while to yourself, you appear to function perfectly. That is, if there's a problem with your mind, and you only have your mind to examine your mind, it's a bit of a minefield. Mind. It's perfectly possible to believe you are sane while everyone around you is confused by your actions. Basically, you can never be sure of your own sanity. Sleep well tonight. Now, I've been using the word insane to describe these mental states, but that's not technically correct. Definitely not anymore. I mean, like, when was the last time you heard about someone going insane? Like, literally, a doctor comes out with his clipboard and a solemn expression and informs the family, "I'm sorry, there's nothing we could do. She's insane." Yeah, never. Insanity as a medical term was being dropped in the 1920s. For example, the American Journal of Insanity, which probably wasn't as wild a read as it sounds, changed its name to the drier American Journal of Psychiatry. While textbooks for student doctors instructed that the word was unscientific and obsolete. Now, professionals prefer the term psychopathology and refer to specific mental disorders. Now, it's time for a thought experiment. This one comes from Adam Smith. Suppose we take an average person. They've grown up on Earth, they're comfortable, can look after themselves, and they prefer the original Wicker Man to the Nick Cage version, so we know they've got sound judgment. Now, we transport them to another planet with a similarly developed civilization, only everything works a bit differently. This person, upon arrival, is required to attend events and speak to all kinds of alien beings, but the manner in which these interactions occur are jarring, irregular, and discordant. It feels almost like being Alice at the Mad Hatter's Tea Party, only this is an entire planet. And while you are definitely of sound mind on Earth, you begin to feel confusion and giddiness that ends at last in lunacy. This tale seems to suggest a social model of mental health, whereby being at odds with one's culture and environment can itself create mental illnesses. According to Scientific American, there is some evidence that mental illnesses can be constrained by national, if not interplanetary, borders. They highlight a condition called Koro, found in Southeast Asia, which is a panic that one's sexual organs are disappearing. It's thought that Koro is confined to cultures where one's reproductive capability is a major determinant of their worth. This all marks a distinct move from condemning the assumed unpredictable and dangerously irrational as insane, and instead seeing them as people with mental disorders. But there's always a but, and there is one situation where people are still called insane, and it's generally done by people wearing silly wigs and waving hammers. Go figure. Remember Tony from Broadmoor? He was there because he pleaded insanity. But if medical professionals say insanity doesn't exist, then how do the courts decide what it means? Well, in the UK, we use a set of rules that came out of a failed assassination attempt of our Prime Minister in 1843. The McNaughton rules are named for Daniel McNaughton, who mistakenly killed the Prime Minister's secretary before being acquitted by reason of insanity and ending up in Broadmoor. just like Tony. The rules state that the defendant must either have not known that the action was wrong, or that they didn't even know they were doing the action, but both must arise from a disease of the mind. Incredibly, even though medical thought has come a long way in the last 170 years, this is still used today in court. And disease of the mind? That's not even the medical term. Academic Thomas Sass neatly sums up the absurdity of this scenario.
Although lawyers and legal scholars never tire of telling us that insanity is a legal term without psychiatric significance, no sooner do they raise the question of insanity than they call for psychiatrists to verify that claim.
So, what does insanity mean in the modern world with no insane people? Where we've cured insanity not through medical research but through a definitional change. Today, insanity is little more than an idea, a relic of a past when those with mental illnesses were treated as children or animals or worse. So maybe think twice before labelling someone insane, unless you're a judge, that is. Thanks for watching. That was What the Hell Does Insanity Mean? But I just had a great weekend in VidCon Europe. It was in Amsterdam. There were loads of great people. It was really cool. We took this massive photo you can see here. And so I actually spent some time looking for a statue of Van Gogh so we could illustrate this video. But there isn't any in Amsterdam, despite there being a massive museum there. But anyway, the next video will be back to science. If you've got any suggestions for new videos, leave them in the comments below. You might have figured out by now that we do three strands. We do science things, idea videos like this, and then sort of objects or things, like the trousers one, which you can check out here. You should watch it, it's good. There you go. Oh, and if you want, I don't like saying subscribe, but you can subscribe. If you're cool. Bye.